Hello everyone. In this session, we'll discuss the basics of design by analysis approach for design of pressure components. The design by analysis was introduced much later in the design course in comparison with the traditional design by rules approach, which was in place since year 1914. In this module, we'll first have a look at different situations which demand analysis approach and then have a brief overview of different types of analysis. We'll have understanding about the essential features of analysis approach and review some of the important concepts. Finally, we'll describe the implementation of this approach into the ASME design code. Let's proceed with the situations in the design of pressure equipment which demand design by analysis approach. The first situation which demands design by analysis approach is the case where we have a lot of openings which are very close to each other, as shown in this figure or in the other figure. Such cases are not covered by the design by rule approach. Another case is that of an opening which is very large in size and it is placed on the knuckle portion of a distend, and such geometries cannot be analyzed by design by rules approach. Some of the openings which are of non-circular types are not covered by the rules, and hence we have to do the analysis. The tube sheet of heat exchanger is an example of a component which is having very complex stress and thermal distribution. For design of this tube sheet, especially for high pressure and high temperature conditions, necessitates the need of design by analysis. Some of the components which are not pressure components but which are what is known as internal components, they have very complex geometries, and such cases again require design by analysis approach. A bolted flange joint is very critical in order to ensure that there is no leakage during the operating part. The portion where the gasket is located is analyzed for the leak tightness so that you can ensure that during the operation, especially for very high pressure joints, no leakage would occur under the operating loads. The situations where you are having an equipment where you already know there is some pre-existing crack, or equipments which are under testing, or simply for failure analysis, you require the fatigue and fracture analysis, which are done for a few cases. There are a variety of analysis types, so let's have a look at these. The first type is the static analysis, which is very commonly used. The analysis can be performed. The main characteristic of this analysis type is that the loads are constant with respect to time. The material model or the geometry model could be either linear or it could be non-linear. The second one is the dynamic. As compared to the static, the dynamic analysis has time component coming into it. That is, either the loads are varying with time or there is some change in the geometry with respect to time. The two main types is that of the buckling analysis, which is done for equipment under external pressure, and secondly for the earthquake analysis or wind analysis, eigenvalue calculations need to be performed. The third important type is the thermal analysis. It is very common in case of heat exchangers and reactors where there is a time dependent variation of fluids inside the equipment. The analysis could be of steady type, that is, you want to establish under steady state what is the temperature distribution, or in the transient type, that is, when you are doing startup of an equipment, what would be the distribution of stresses for a transient period or during the startup period. The fatigue and fracture types of analysis are not that commonly done. They are done mainly for establishing design for very critical conditions or for failure analysis. The last two types, that is piping and structural, as such are not a different analysis type. They are a combination of static, dynamic and thermal analysis. However, there are specialized softwares for piping or structural analysis. So I have given these two as a different types. In most of the cases, you will be looking at the static structural analysis, that is the first type, and the second is the thermal analysis followed by static structural analysis to establish the thermal stresses. Let's have a look at some of the features of stress analysis. The first important feature of a stress analysis is definition of category of loading. Each loading type has a different hazard level for the vessel and as such has a different allowable limit when you are doing analysis. Once we have established different loads, you combine them into different load cases and do the detailed stress analysis to obtain the stress distribution for each of the load case. So this is done for each load case. Once you have done this, you apply the failure theory. The failure theory is as prescribed by the design code or standard that you are using. And you combine the different stress components, those are available from finite element software or whatever software you are using. Depending on the load category, you have to adopt a different allowable stress limits for each of the category or each of the load case. These allowable limits or the factor of safeties are mostly higher as compared to the design by rules approach. That is, if design by rules approach has got a factor of safety of 3.5 or on ultimate tensile strength, the design by analysis rules will have factor of safety which will be 3, which is less than 3.5. Let's have a look at some of the concepts which are used in the analysis. The first concept is that of the true stress and strain. As we know, the material data is mostly available in terms of engineering stress and strains, whereas in the finite element analysis, we use the true stress and true strains. These values, for example, in the graph which is shown, the dotted line gives the variation of engineering stress strain curve, whereas the dark line gives the true stress strain variation. The relationship between true stress and engineering stress and true strain and engineering stress strain is given by the equations which are there in this slide. The second concept is that of the different material models those are required. The first model is that of the elastic model, which is not shown on the screen, but it simply assumes that stress is directly proportional to strain forever. So in this model, there is no concept of yield and the materials will have stress level which can cross the yield limit. And for this model, there are different allowable stresses. When you are considering plasticity of the material, there are different approximate models are available. The purpose of these approximations is to reduce the computational time that is required to solve. The first approximation is the model which is elastic plus perfectly plastic. In this case, after the yield strength, the material behaves as perfectly plastic and it starts flowing irrespective of any increase of the load, the stress level remains constant. The second approximation is after yielding, you consider the variation to be a linear one, but it is not flat one as shown for the perfectly plastic model. And the last model is actual stress strain data you can provide. So your model can be taken as a data obtained from actual experiments. However, it becomes more computationally demanding. And if you are not doing accurate analysis or failure analysis, this approach is in general not common. Also, many finite element software give some of the material models which are useful if your material happens to be one of the common ones. One such example is the Ramberg-Osgood relationship or Ramberg-Osgood model, which has got two model parameters, H and N. These parameter values for your material can be obtained from the design data book. Once you have these values, you can simply supply these parameters to your analysis software and it will simulate the stress-strain relationship as close to the real material as possible. There are different failure theories. The one which is most commonly used is the von Mises theory, which is given in terms of this elliptical shape on the principal plane shown here. There are different failure theories used in different codes. Let's have a look at them. The ASME Section 8 Division 2, the latest edition, has been using the von Mises theory. The ASME Section 8 Division 1 uses the maximum principal stress theory, and the older editions of Division 2 before 2007 were using the maximum shear stress theory. As we have seen, the loading forms an important part of design by analysis approach. The loading can be categorized into normal loading, which includes the internal and external pressure, the dead weight, the weight of vessel contents, the piping and attachment reactions, the vessel supports and the reactions they exert on the vessel, and the thermal loading which is acting on the vessel. The occasional loadings which are having a different factor of safety include the wind loading, seismic loading, snow loading. So all these three are climatic loading. The erection and transportation loading, shop and field hydrotest loading, and the loading which occurs during startup and shutdown of the equipment. These loading types are combined to form different load cases. So the different load combinations which are considered in the design are as prescribed by ASME code are given here. So if you are performing the analysis, you will have to consider different load cases. As for example, in ASME Section 8 Division 2 prescribes 8 different load cases, and you have to check your component for each of these load cases and see to it that it satisfies the given allowable limits. Within each of these loads, that is, for example, P is design pressure. So what all conditions or what are further details of this particular load type are also given in the design code. This slide gives you during normal operation, for example, what type of loading needs to be considered. So you can read it from the handouts or the PDF files which are supplied to you separately. You will not be able to read it on the screen. So in the normal operation, you have to consider the dead load of components plus insulation, refractory, reproofing, installed internals, catalyst, packing, platforms, and other equipment supported from the equipment. So like this, there are many details of loadings which must be considered during the analysis are given by the design code. So as an analysis approach, you need to go through these details and make sure that you include all those effects in your calculations. Let me summarize this session. Certain geometric and loading features demand design by analysis approach. There are a variety of analysis types. The major ones which are relevant for pressure equipment design are first the static structural analysis and second thermomechanical analysis. The design by analysis approach calls for accurate evaluation of different loading types acting on the equipment and prescribe a different acceptance criteria for each of these loading types. In the next session, we will look into further details of design by analysis approach to the design. I thank you for your attention. Goodbye, everyone.